maybe some interim mistakes in quantum mechanics calculation, you know, mind may be sort of interface that consider the world as a world, the possibility of some subtlety. So there's some ways.
So I'm going to be talking about some work I've been doing with Hong Liu and Matthew Rutberg and two papers at TH. There's some closely related works by Slavinger and McCreevy and Horowitz and Polchinski. And, new technology. There seems to be some impression that a lot of people have that there's a big disagreement among these papers. And let me say at the outset that as far as I'm aware, we're all in agreement on the physics that we'll be discussing. So I will give you some introduction and motivation, talk about the geometry of some time-dependent orbital folds, say a little bit about solutions of the wave equations on them, and twisted sectors, and conclude, and make some allusions to tomorrow's talk. As you all know, the nature of time in general relativity is subtle, and there are deep and well-known conceptual problems. So one might hope that in exactly solvable string backgrounds, and string theory is a theory of quantum gravity, one might hope to address some of these problems. But in trying to think about string theory in interestingly time-dependent backgrounds, you rapidly run into a number of complicated conceptual and technical problems, and among the many problems, I'll be focusing on one, that of back reaction. I'll actually mostly be discussing kinematics today, and a companion talk by Nadi Zyberg tomorrow will focus more on the dynamical issues. Now, there are two well-known sources of back reaction effects. If you don't have supersymmetry, as you generically don't in time-dependent backgrounds, there could be tachyons and infrared instabilities. And if you have closed causal curves, then there are potential infinities in loop amplitudes and in evaluating expectation values of composite oscillators. In this talk, we're going to look at some simple models where both of these effects are under control, and nevertheless, string perturbation theory is not well-defined. And even if you think that we'll have additional integers, and at least the divergences of string perturbation theory even to true level. On the positive side, we'll also find that there are no winds of time-dependent backgrounds where string perturbation theory is well-defined, and that leaves some room for further progress. Now, time-dependent backgrounds are very difficult to work with, so it's a good idea to work with something exactly solvable, like an orbital fold. And so we'll look at orbital folds of Gaussian space by a discrete subgroup of the Poincaré group. This is a class of models introduced by Horowitz and Spice about 12 years ago, and recently it's been the subject of much interest in many papers. A very simple example of what we're discussing is to take the orbital fold group to be Z, with generator G naught, X trivially on 8 dimensions, non-trivially on 1 plus 1 dimensions, here are the light-term coordinates, G naught to the NX as a discrete boost. So, we have, what do we pay for our orbital group gamma? Well, some criterion you might want to impose are time-dependent bounds, because that's what we're interested in. You might want to have undoubted supersymmetry, and we'll ask that there be no closed time-like curves, and some immediate implications of that are, first of all, from the unbroken supersymmetry, no string vector, so we can use light-term gauge. We have no particle production, so we have a lot of simplifications. We are discussing a very simple version of a PP wave, so we're on topic. And from results of Figueroa et al., somewhat less obviously, it follows that gamma must be a certain discrete subgroup of this extension of spin 7 by two Euclidean groups. So, when you start to look at such orbital folds, if you look at examples, you start to find some strange things happening. In the case of Euclidean orbital folds, we really know what are the physical consistent criteria we want to impose to have a good model, to essentially anomaly cancellation, but we don't know what the criteria are in the Lorentzian case. For example, fixed points, unlike the Euclidean case, fixed points can lead to pathologies. Even if you don't have fixed points, you might have closed causal curves, and these can also lead to pathologies. Even if you don't have fixed points and you don't have closed causal curves, you can have stranger phenomena, like nearly closed null curves, that is an infinite sequence of space-like geodesics whose length tends to zero. This is another kind of, this will lead to pathology. You can have explosive degeneracy for the twisted sector, by which I mean the sum of the partition functions over the twisted sector can diverge. And then you can have this problem of bushes, and this is the one I'm going to be focusing on, because this is probably a generic effect. So, indeed, in the rest of the talk, the orbital group is just going to be the integer, Z. It's generated by G naught, and G naught acts as follows on 10-dimensional Minkowski space. X plus and X minus are light-term coordinates. X vector is in the 8-dimensional transverse plane. So G naught as a function of lambda of V and R acts by a shift in the transverse space, and then the dependence on V here gives me a parabolic Lorentz transformation. Now, if we only have one generator, we might as well simplify this as much as possible. So by conjugation, we can take V to point in the one direction and R to point in the two direction, and if V is non-zero, you can even set it to be 1, Now he wants to set it to be too high.